This session will be recorded. I'm going to try and keep it at 45 minutes or less to just be aware of the time. And I think I can cover everything I need to in that period of time. The other two sessions will be a little bit later in the semester where essentially we're covering more complicated material, especially things like, you know, how to successfully do an online search, use the GIGNDC library databases, and also correct documentation procedures, as well as the final research paper. So essentially, if you've looked at all at the course schedule this semester, one of the things you'll notice is that the student schedule, which is tentative and subject to change, but the assignments are less complicated initially, but they build on each other. And that's the reason I don't open an entire semester. Well, there's several reasons, but a semester's worth of work at one time, because we kind of take it as a progression and emphasize different aspects of the writing process, and the assignments get more complicated because they build on each other, you know, as we progress through the semester. Now, as I said in the course orientation video, which I do hope you watched, although it's a little bit older, so the formatting and some of the information's changed, but a summer semester, you're essentially covering 15 weeks worth of material, the entire curriculum for English 1101 that's approved at the state level, and you're covering it in 10 weeks. So please be aware that if sometimes, in some weeks, you know, the workload will vary, but if some weeks seem a little bit more intense as far as the assignments and what's required of you than others, it's simply because we are having to condense down and cover a lot of information in a shorter period of time. I do try and streamline this a bit, so some of the smaller assignments that I tend to give that are more supplemental, I'll often take out in the summer course if I find they're covered by, you know, some other method. Also, I wanted to let you know about my grading procedures. Normally, I wait to grade information the week after it's due. So, for example, assignments open at a week folder opens on Tuesday mornings at 8 o'clock for the week, with the exception of holiday. Okay, if there happens to be a holiday and it sort of skews everything. But normally, the next week's folder will open at Tuesday morning at 8 a.m. and will close the following Monday. That's normally kind of the time frame we're working within. Again, the exception, for example, we have an exception this week because it's Memorial Day, which is a holiday. It's a GNTC holiday. So your assignments won't actually be due until Tuesday night rather than Monday night, which is our normal parameter. So what I frequently do is wait to grade information until after it's closed, because unfortunately I have a lot of students who don't submit things until the very last minute. And so what I do is sort of grade a class's work all at one time, and so everybody's work is not in. Now, that's not always the case, but please be aware. I know, you know, you often students get frustrated and want their grades right away, but that's normally what's going on, unless the system grades it. So, for example, the quiz that you have this week, the reading check quiz, is graded by the system. I don't have to go in and manually do anything. So that grade is available to you a little bit quicker. Also be aware that if at any time during the semester you want to, you know, one of the keys to success in this course is communication, especially if you have questions or concerns. So via email, I'm always available during the week. It's another reason, by the way, to not wait till the last minute to do assignments, because I don't answer email after roughly 5 o'clock on Monday nights. Okay, so I don't do that. I don't take that work home with me. So if you have questions, I won't be there to or run into some trouble. I won't be there to help. But please don't hesitate to email me or to call. The phone number is on the syllabus. Or if you'd like to schedule an appointment, what we would do is pretty much similar to this. Again, you don't have to have a video necessarily, as long as you have audio, but you can use the schedule an appointment tab, which is on the left-hand side of the menu, and set up a time to meet with me. I will be glad to meet with you. And this is a way too that, like, for example, if you're working on a paper and you have a question, I can actually pull up the paper here on the screen and we can work together. Okay. So if you don't have any questions about that, we're going to get started because what I want to do is set up this first paper for you, let you know the expectations, how to go about, you know, the process we're going to use, and answer any questions that you have. Last week you did a right brain, left brain assessment for me, and it's by no means scientific, as I said in my feedback, but it's a little bit helpful because it explains how students tend to approach writing. I found it useful for me when I've taken the quiz, and over time, quite frankly, I moved from being a more left-brained writer and a more left-brained person with those tendencies to being more right-brained, so please be aware that it does change. But here's why it's valid for this particular course. If you did the reading assignment for this week, if you've gotten to it yet, you know, the assignment emphasizes the fact that writing is a process rather than just an end product. That's sort of a revolutionary idea. When I was in high school and college, writing was taught as a product. We were given an assignment, we were given a due date, and that was pretty much it. The idea was you could teach grammar, maybe, but there wasn't much that you could teach about the process itself. In the 70s and 80s, the 1970s and 80s, there was a revolution in teaching writing, because what researchers did was they began to study how professional writers actually write. And what they found was that professional writers go through a whole process before they arrive at an end product. The exception being probably things like reporters who, you know, have to turn a story around really quickly, but they have a formula to follow. As a matter of fact, those questions that you're supposed to answer this week as one of your pre-writing assignments, it's called the reporter's formula. Who, what, when, where, why, and sometimes how, whichever ones of those apply. If you read a pure news story, you'll notice in the first paragraph to two paragraphs, it will answer all of those questions. Who did it? Where it happened? When it happened? How it happened? And why? Sometimes why it happened. So they follow a particular formula, but most professional writers actually are always collecting information. They're writing out ideas. They play around with ideas. They use various forms of visualization to webbing and clustering and jotting things down and listing. Reading is a form of pre-writing, as is research. And they're always collecting information. As a matter of fact, most professional writers will always have a little notebook with them, and you can see them jotting down ideas for something they're going to write. Then another thing that we know about professional writers is that they always revise. It's only a beginning writer who thinks that he or she needs to write something down for the first time and it needs to be perfect, and then it's submitted and that's the end of it. That's the mark, honestly, of a beginner. Professional writers go back and look at what they've said. They often, if they have a sort of a cooling off period, and they can come back to what they wrote, they can see where the errors are. They also have readers who provide feedback. And I don't mean just editors who go in and will mark up their copy, but I mean also, if you look at the fly page of any book, one of the first pages in a novel or even a nonfiction piece, what you'll see is there will be a dedication and an acknowledgement of the readers, the people who actually read through the material and, you know, gave feedback to the writer. So, in these stages, one of the things that we know is that the earlier the stage of the process, the more right-brained the activity. So those of you who tend to be a bit more right-brained probably kind of enjoy pre-writing more. You're more exploratory. You're more comfortable with associations. You're more careful. It's like you're a little bit more liberated to play around outside the rules, okay? And so that tends to require more. That's more of a right-brained activity, all these pre-writing activities. For example, I would guess that people who actually do pre-writing, but they paragraph, the free write activity that's assigned for this week, but you paragraph, I would guess you tend to be a little bit more left-brained because that's what you're comfortable with, and that's the rule, right? So often left-brain writers need to do more pre-writing. Right-brain writers like it. Okay. So the in pre-writing, by the way, there are several words, different words that we use interchangeably, like creating, invention strategy. So I'll kind of, you know, if I use more than one term for this earlier part of the process, that's what I'm talking about. With invention, you consider your length, your purpose, your occasion, and your audience. You choose and focus your topic, and you discover what you have to say. Okay. Now, a lot of students feel like that this is more making more work for them, but actually it will save you time. For example, let's say you have a topic in mind that you want to use for an assignment. In 5 minutes, you can often find out if you have enough to say about that topic just by doing some type of free write or some type of activity to explore the ideas. All right, in arrangement, you decide how to structure, and this often has to do with coming, with arriving at what we call the rhetorical situation. Sorry, it's hard for me to type and think at the same time. The rhetorical situation is the purpose for writing, the actual message that you have, the audience for that message, and the form it's going to take, okay, whether it be essay format or whatever. So that's what the rhetorical situation is, and that's where you make these types of decisions. Now you're moving from the right brain to more left brain type activity. It's still somewhat right brain as you're making these decisions, as is drafting and revising. This is where you get your thoughts down on paper in a somewhat organized manner, and then revising simply means re-seeing what you've written. And being willing to make changes. This too requires both sides of your brain, right? Now, when we get to the proofreading and editing, this the part of the process where you're actually making decisions about, okay, did I use commas correctly here? Do I need to phrase this differently? Are all of my ideas connected? This is purely left-brained. This is applying the grammar rules, okay? This is what a grammar handbook is all about. It's essentially, these are the rules for how to, you know, make a something that, write something that's easily accessible to an audience. So this is why writing can be so difficult. Those who tend to be left brain dominant often have trouble coming up with ideas and finding enough to say about their topic. And a left brain person, I can give an assignment and they will think, I can write this, I can, you know, cover this in one paragraph. Why do I need five, right? And then a left brain writer will often take five paragraphs to say what should have been said in one. So you can kind of see the difference there. Often left brain writers, their structure, their syntax, their grammar is flawless. And syntax simply means the way you're putting your sentences together, the way you word your sentences. But often they're writing, they struggle with ideas and their writing's not as developed. Now, this does not apply across the board. These are generalizations, but this is just a tendency. And so the early stages of the writing process really help left-brain writers, okay? Those who tend to be more right-brain often have flair, and their writing is often very interesting. It's got a lot of personality. There's a lot of detail. However, they have more trouble often being organized and sticking with a thesis, sticking with a topic, okay? So the later stages of the process, especially in revision, is helpful. And I'm going to give some strategies for helping, you know, both types of writers. Does somebody have a question? All right. Well, if not, then let's talk about the essay itself that you're beginning this week. Okay. If we were actually in a class, I would, let me make this a little bit larger so you can see it, but this is the handout. These are the guidelines that I provided for you earlier. They're provided in the folder. I recommend if you have access to a printer to print them out, just because you have, they'll be an easy reference for you. And throughout the semester, this is the format I'll use for all assignments. you know, that are formal and lengthy. Okay, so this is your first 100-point assignment, and we're going to take it as a process. So that's the reason this week I'm having you do two things. I'm having you do a couple of pre-writing activities to start collecting your thoughts and exploring subjects, and then I'm having you write a draft. Okay, so that's this week is devoted to these earlier stages of the process. And then next week, by next Thursday, and I'll show you how to access the feedback, but I will read through what you've written. Now, this is just a draft. What you're submitting to me this week after you, are the pre-writing activities, and I just give you credit for doing them. That's not a grade as far as did you do them right? Did you, you know, is the content good? You just essentially receive participation credit. The draft as well, you get 10 points just for submitting a draft. Okay. Now please be aware, I don't take late drafts. So this draft is due by next Tuesday night. I do take papers late. If you look at the late work policy on the syllabus, I do go over my guidelines for I will accept a paper up to 3 days late with a penalty, a 10% per day penalty. On the fourth day after the final paper itself is due, I won't accept it. Okay, but normally because students we go through this drafting process and they have enough time to work on their assignments, even assignments that aren't that difficult, these formal essays. Usually that's not a problem. Students almost always get their papers in on time. Now, if we were in an actual face-to-face class, I would distribute these guidelines, give you a chance to read them, and then I would go over them with you. I don't want to waste your time telling you what you can read for yourself, obviously, but I do want to add some of my philosophy behind these guidelines to explain, you know, why I'm asking you to do certain things. All right. The first particular mode we're using, the type of writing you're doing, is a description essay. And in this case, you choose a person, a place, or a thing, or event. I think I mentioned event as well as an option that you want to explore. Now, it needs to be just one, okay? Because this is a fairly short paper. This is not very lengthy. 600 to 750 words is a rather short assignment. Okay, it's about 2.5 pages maybe typed. You may write it in first person. Now, please be aware as the assignments become more complicated and more academic, they also become more objective, which means that you should not write from first person. All right, and first person being I. It needs to be, you know, one or people or some more third person. And we'll talk more about that in future assignments. But this one, it certainly may be written from a personal perspective if you like. For example, the professional sample essay about Miss Bessie that I'm having you read this week is written from Carl Rowan, the author's perspective, his experiences with this particular teacher. Not all of it is about him. A lot of it focuses on her and it's a little broader, but there are several paragraphs that are devoted to his personal experience with this particular woman. Okay. So it's fine with me if you want to do that with this particular paper. Okay. Now, notice the paper does need a main point or thesis. It's not just description for description's sake. But there's got to be a point to it. And that's what a thesis is. It's the main idea that you, the writer, want the reader to get across about this person, this place, this event, this thing. So be sure to select a subject that lends itself to that type of focus. Okay. So you're going to complete one of these two pre-writing activities that's going to help you sort of generate information. By the way, if you start doing a free write and you find that you don't have enough to say, that's probably a hint to you to change your topic. Okay. Also, if you tend toward writer's block, you know, where you can't think of anything to say, free writing will get you over that. Because notice that number one, it gets you started. You've got something down on paper to work with and to go back and to think about and to reshape, even if you don't use everything in that free write. Although some students actually can lift whole sections of their free writing and use them in their drafts. For some students, it's just a start, you know, just to get some ideas down on paper. But at least it does get you started. So free writing is a great way to get over writer's block, by the way. And writer's block is an entirely left brain problem. It's trying to spell everything correctly, ideas, organize them, connect them, put the commas in the right all at the same time. It's really too much to ask, okay? So be aware that there are ways around that, and usually it's by doing some pre-writing, taking the pressure off yourself. All right, we will go through a two-week process. Each draft receives a 10-point completion grade. In this case, there's only one draft. And then the overview of requirements, of course, focusing on person, place, thing, or event. Have a thesis or controlling message. An implied thesis simply means that there's no one sentence that the reader could point to and say, okay, that's what this paper is about. Explicit means that it's you can usually find it in the introduction. That's where most a thesis normally goes. It's the last sentence in the introduction of a paper. You do need to include good description and concrete detail, which we'll talk about in a second. It should be between 600 and 750 words. Now, here's why I give word counts. I don't like to. Because often I find students write to fit the word count. But if you think of it like a target, all right, so right here would be the bullseye, all right, so 650 to 750 words. Here is a little bit longer or a little bit shorter. So a little bit longer could be, say fudge up to 900 words. And by the way, Microsoft Word does give you a word count in the bottom left-hand corner. Shorter, say 550. So it needs to be somewhere in that range. So that would be the sort of outer. And then if it's really kind of barely on the target, what that simply means is you haven't written to fit the assignment. You either haven't come up with enough to say, or you've come up with too much to say and you're not controlling your information. Yes, Jaleesa, do you have a question? Please feel free to ask it or to.
For the draft or the final?
The draft itself will get credit as long as you've got several, 3 to 4 paragraphs and when you submit it. But realize that the better the draft, the more that I can just help you focus on like smaller issues. If you have big developmental issues, for example, if what you submit to me as a draft is only a couple of paragraphs, there's not a lot I can tell you because there's a lot more work that you need to do, right? I might can make some suggestions about how to proceed, but for the most part, you haven't given me enough to work with to really kind of move you forward and start looking at just the little bitty details. So what I would tell you is the better the draft, the better. The closer you can get it to where you're somewhat satisfied with it, still realizing it's a draft, the more that I can help you with things like transitions, with spelling and punctuation. If I know you've got to do a lot of revision, if the paper needs a lot of work, if it's a really early stage draft, which we'll talk about in a second, then I'm not going to focus on grammar at all. Okay, I can't because I realize you're going to make a lot of changes. Does that make sense?
No, yeah, but the final draft, does it have to be 4 paragraphs?
It has to be a minimum of 4 paragraphs, yes. Oh. If you think about it, like normally, and I'm gonna give you some information on structure next week's lesson. I just didn't want to kind of overwhelm students this week. But this is kind of a simple, rudimentary, my drawing is not wonderful. But if you look at, say, 4 paragraphs, all right, the first you have an introductory paragraph that sets up what you want to say, and then it leads down, so it starts maybe a little bit generally, and then it leads down to your thesis statement, which is the main point of the paper, right? And it's usually the last sentence. So it kind of guides the reader toward a point. Then these are the body paragraphs. These are chunks, right? Normally a good body paragraph is a minimum of 5 sentences, okay? Normally, because it has to do with development and having a clear idea and then adequately developing it within each paragraph. So normally you need at least a minimum of 2 of those that actually come back and support this point. Okay. And then finally, your last paragraph is your concluding paragraph. And that's where you ease readers back out of what you wanted to say. It doesn't usually contain main ideas at all. It either summarizes them or it refers back to the introduction. And so the paper actually feels concluded. So that's the reason I say you need a minimum of four. One to set it up, two to three to kind of develop the ideas, to really get into the guts, right, of what you want to say. And then a concluding paragraph that kind of wraps everything up. Right. Does that help?
And yes, and for the pre-writing, does it, can it just be like a paragraph or something? Like, well, I'm just like, basically what I'm going to write? It doesn't have to be in full detail, right?
For the draft, is that what you're asking? The pre-write can just be, matter of fact, I recommend students not worry about paragraphing at all. You just literally have a timer and just sit there and write everything you can think of. Don't worry about spelling, don't worry about punctuation. It can be one big run-on sentence if you want it to be. It doesn't really matter, because the main idea is to kind of free your brain to come up with things that it may not if you're trying to, like, spell things right and indent paragraphs and that kind of thing. Does that make sense? So the free writing can be, it doesn't, as a matter of fact, it shouldn't be paragraphed. So.
Oh, sorry, I got kicked out. Sort of lagging.
Okay, yeah, that's fine. The free writing should not be in paragraph form. Yeah, it's more exploratory. It's more, if anything, like playful, associative, something like that. Okay. So the draft itself doesn't have to necessarily fit these, within these parameters, but be aware if it's really long, I'm going to try and help you figure out how to cut it back down to revise to fit those parameters. If it's really short, I'm going to try and help you figure out how to add more information, where the information should come, and try and make recommendations about those types of things. But what that means is that I will not be looking at grammar, because you're still at the stage where you're adding to what you're writing or subtracting down what you're writing. Does that help?
Yes. And for the description essay, I can like write anything, right?
You want to choose your subject for the paper, and that's what the pre-writing activities are about. Mm-hmm. Either the person you select, or the place, or the thing, or the event.
And so I can choose like a random thing, like for my house. Like, is it like memorable or not? Like, you know what I'm talking about?
Only if you want to write an essay about it.
Okay.
Yeah. See, the description, those description pre-writing activities are pre-writing for the paper. So they should be about whatever subject you're going to write about for the paper.
Mm-hmm. And
does that help?
Yes. Mostly should we just focus on the writing, how to describe it, right? So, like, it can't be that much information, like any informant, type of information that require information.
If you're asking about the purpose in writing, yes, it can be to inform, it can be to explain, it can be to, there's several different purposes. I think that section, the section that you read, will talk about that. Also, if you look at the student paper as well as the Miss Bessie essay, it will give you an example of how to write while making a point, having a thesis.
No. Oh, okay.
Okay.
I think I understand now.
Okay. All right. I'm gonna finish going over this, and I've got a couple of other things to tell you. If you don't mind muting, if you don't have another question, thank you. So you want to follow, this needs to be, what I would recommend that you do is type it as a Word document and then just upload it to the Dropbox. Please use a regular font. Please make sure that it's black ink. You want a double space between your lines to make it easier to read. You want to indent the first line of each paragraph and use 1-inch margins, okay? That's just normal formatting procedure. It should be submitted in draft form in the week 2 folder. I'll show you about that in a second. You do need a title. It shouldn't be description essay. All right. But you do need a title that's relevant to the content of the paper. And then the header, of course, I'll show you, it's on the back page. And then the final version you should revise, and there'll be a Dropbox for it in the week 3 folder. These are your due dates: Tuesday for the draft, Thursday my feedback will be available to you, and then the following Monday the final revised essay is due in this folder. Okay, and then here's what, if you're looking at your page, this is what the header should look like: your name, English 1101, my name, and then the date, and then double space below that, center your title. All right, anybody have any questions about these guidelines? Okay, if not, let me go over with you. This information is on your syllabus, but I wanted to review it so that you'll understand. Let me make this a bit smaller. So that you'll understand, the very top comment on your draft will be either an M, an E, an M, or an L designation, because most students want to know when they submit a paper, when they turn it in, you know, if you were to grade it on this day, what grade would I receive? Again, we are talking about drafts, okay? And so what I do is I use a letter designation. E means it's an early stage draft, okay? You've got something down on paper, you've got to start, but there are probably usually issues with development, which means you haven't written enough, you haven't kind of, or you haven't, you don't have a thesis or something like that. And so if I were to grade the draft on that day, it would not receive above a D. But the good news is I tell you how to fix it, okay? An M indicates that it's a middle stage draft. There is some successful development in support of your thesis, some originality of thought. It's solid. It's solid work. And so if I were to grade that draft on that day, it would receive a C. Sometimes if you have a lot of technical errors, major sentence errors, commas, those types of punctuation, if there are enough of them, then that too would indicate a C designation. And then finally, a late stage draft means that the paper is really working. There are not a lot of grammatical problems. And if I were to grade it on that day, it would receive a B or an A. Sometimes, probably more frequently than not, I use either E/M or sometimes M/L. And what that means is it's sort of between an E and an M, all right? It's somewhere in the high 60s to low 70s, high D, low C, or high C, low B. And that just, again, the good news is it's just giving you information about your paper currently. And then the good news is, because it is a draft, I tell you how to fix it. Okay, so please be aware that will be the top comment that I will type on your drafts. Now, unfortunately, and I say unfortunately, I don't know if you've ever used Turnitin as a Dropbox for submitting grades. That's my preferred method for providing feedback, but there is a chance that Turnitin is going to go away this summer. That Blackboard at the state level is no longer going to support that particular program. And so I'm not going to use it in case it wipes out your grades until we know for sure. So I'm using an alternative. And we'll just see how this works. Here's our homepage. Now, of course, by the way, here is, let's see. Here under my grades, this is what the gradebook looks like. Unfortunately, I can't show you a student view. I can only show you from an instructor perspective. I, of course, don't have any written assignments. But where there's a grade under my grades, you should be able to select that, and it will open up your assignment, and you should be able to access the assignment itself, go back to it, and look at my comments. And often, too, some of the comments will be written right here on the side. And so I'm hoping that, again, I can't see what you see, unfortunately, so I can't show you what that looks like or give you very good instructions because I don't have that access to student view, but that's how you should be able to go back next Thursday, a week from today, after 4 o'clock, and retrieve your feedback. And what I will do is I'll not only type feedback, but I will also record, tape record my comments to give you some suggestions. Okay. Now to finish, I want to talk for just a second about description and about why it's so important. Often what I find, it is possible to have too much description in an essay, right? Description for description's sake can often be unwieldy and overwhelming. But in my experience, most students tend to not have enough. All right. So a descriptive essay is basically trying to make something come to life, whether, again, it be a person, place, thing, or event. You're trying to recreate it so that the reader can connect. And the book talks about, you know, a sensory description. Sensory description means that the description is accessible in through your five senses. We tend to think of it being visual, right, that we can picture it, but it's also smell, taste, touch, sound. By the way, recreating dialogue, people talking with quotation marks, is a great way to recreate sound. So I would encourage you, especially if you're writing about a person, to include dialogue in the paper. Now, English teachers are notorious for saying that we want you to show rather than tell. And what that means is that you provide enough detail and description so that whatever you're writing about comes to life. Okay. Let me give you a quick example. Probably most of you are not alive during the big snowstorm that hit here in 1993, but I was. I lived a quarter mile from the nearest neighbor back in the woods in Rocky Face, Georgia, with my two daughters and a dog. And we woke up, had no electricity, which also meant we had no running water because my water was on a well system. My father had warned me that it was coming, and so I prepared by renting Blockbuster videos. This is pre-streaming, right? So I thought I wanted to have some entertainment, and I got the baby some diapers, and I got some canned food. Well, we woke up, and none of that worked, right? So my electric can opener didn't work. Nothing worked. But after 3 days, the electricity was back on, and we were fine. All right, that's me telling you what happened. Let me show you what happened. It was about 6:30 on a Friday night, and my father, who is a weather watcher and lived in Memphis, Tennessee, called me and he said, "Gail, you need to get ready because there's a big storm coming. They're pretty sure it's going to hit. And so you need to be prepared for a big snowstorm." So I did. I bundled up my two little girls. Jillian was six. I mean, she was three, and Emily was 6 months. And we went to the little town, and I did buy some diapers. I went to Blockbuster. I rented three videos, and I did get some canned food, brought it back to the house. We woke up the next morning, and the temperature was 66 degrees in the house and dropping. Now, I had a little wood-burning stove downstairs, so I essentially kept a fire going. I had thought to put some wood against the house. There was an overhang, and so I kept the fire going in this wood-burning stove, which I later found out was not up to code, could have burned the house down. So I melted snow on that little stove, and so we would have water since, of course, we were on a well system. The problem was that where the wood-burning stove was located, which was around the kitchen area, there were just openings. There were no, like, doors to close. So I got quilts, and I tacked them up over the entryways so that we could keep some of the heat in the house. And I didn't know enough really to be scared, so my kids and I would go out and play, and I had a German Shepherd dog named Maddie, And, you know, some of the snowdrifts were so high that they came up to her chest. She really couldn't even, like, play all that much. And we did fine. And after about 3 days, now I didn't have a can opener, and I didn't have a screw can opener, which I realize now I'll never be without again. So I ruined two good knives, like opening cans with that, with my knives to be able to heat up, you know, vegetables and different types of food on the stove. After 3 days, one of my dad's best friends, I saw him walking down the street because there was no traffic. I really was a quarter mile from the nearest neighbor and couldn't, you know, really walk down this long driveway and get to anybody. And so I said, "Gene, what are you doing here?" And he said, "You know, your dad has called the National Guard. Your dad has called the local police trying to get somebody out there to make sure you guys are still alive." And he came in and I fixed him a cup of tea. And while he was there, the electricity came back on. So that's me showing you what happened. If I were to ask you, even 2 to 3 weeks from now, which I often do in face-to-face classes, what do you remember from the story I just told you? People will remember the details. They sometimes remember the name of the dog or the my kids' names, or they'll remember their ages. They remember the, you know, that was 66 degrees and dropping. We remember detail because that's what we as readers connect to, or listeners as audience members connect to. So this, for example, is a very general paragraph. Now, when we're talking about description and detail, we're talking about two things. We're talking about adjectives and adverbs. So those are descriptive words, right? Such as hurriedly, admittedly, beautiful, quickly, you know, those are the words that actually add life to nouns. But we're also talking about concrete nouns. And that's the difference. That's one of the differences in what I, the example I just gave you was, instead of talking in generalities, I talked in specifics. I named names. I gave degrees. You know, that's specific. I talked about what breed my dog was. Those are specific. So, for example, in this paragraph tells rather than shows. It's very general. Our vacation spot is perfect for my family. It's close enough so that we can drive to it in one day, and it offers many activities to please the whole family. It's important to go during the right season, however, because the weather can become very unpleasant otherwise. Usually we stay just long enough to feel rested when we return. We can even take the family pet because it is a pet-friendly environment. A close relative told us about this special place years ago, and we've used it as a family retreat ever since. Now, notice that there's some adjectives here. There's close. There's pet friendly. There's vacation. Enough is actually an adverb. Whole family. Unpleasant. So it's not that it doesn't have some descriptive words, but what it lacks is concrete nouns. All right. So let me show you a revision of this paragraph. Instead of our vacation spot, it became Gatlinburg, Tennessee. If you were to do this activity in class, you could fill in your own blank there, right? It's a perfect vacation spot for, instead of whole family, you know, this became more specific for my husband and me. It is only, instead of close enough, it became 2.5 hours. Can you see how that's more concrete? Those are the things that we connect to. Offers so many activities. And then the next sentence actually adds the activities. Because, you know, what I may enjoy and you may enjoy may be two different things. So while my husband likes to hike the trails, I can go shopping. We both like to ice skate and play miniature golf. So again, this is how you show rather than tell. The next sentence in the previous paragraph, in the original paragraph, talked about, you know, we stay long enough so that we feel rested. Well, how long is that? You know, for some people that takes a week. In this case, I used 2 nights. All right. Then it talked about it being pet friendly. I can bring our dog. Well, in this case, named not only the breed, but provided the dog's name. Then it said a close relative told us about the place. Well, now here's a proper noun. My Uncle George. That's showing rather than telling. And then it said several years ago. I changed that to be very specific, 5 years ago. All right. So this is part of what, when we refer to showing rather than telling, this is part of what we're talking about. And one of the reasons I wanted to assign this particular type of essay early in the semester was to give you an opportunity to work on those skills of adding life to what you write by providing, yes, adjectives, yes, adverbs, but also specific concrete nouns, because that is effective writing. Okay, that's 45 minutes. Does anyone have any questions for me over anything I've gone over? All right, if not, have a good afternoon. I will send out a link for this video probably a little bit later tonight so that if you need to look back at anything, you'd be able to do so, but those students who couldn't join us will be able to view what we've just gone over. Please don't hesitate to contact me too if you have any questions.
Thank you.